According to a recent survey, most British citizens disapprove of the Duke and Duchess of Sussex's decision to release their Netflix documentary. Almost 6 in 10 people thought the idea was a wrong move for the couple to make the controversial programme, while only a third thought it was a good idea. So what in the world caused this to occur? Big question now is, how did we get here? In the opening minutes of this Netflix's 6-hour deep dive into the Duke of Sussex's self-imposed isolation in California, he poses this issue. Also, if he's puzzled, it's understandable that we would feel the same way halfway through this marathon of emotional bearing. So are these latest revelations and story of Harry and Meghan making them a couple on the brink of royal banishment? It's time to now look into the fascinating world of this extraordinary royal double act. And please like the video and consider subscribing for more historical stories. A once naughty and carefree youth has matured into a brooding and resentful adult, cut off from his extended family and now clinging desperately to his sassy and stunning spouse. Prince Harry was an energetic and defiant 5-year-old, a boy who was full of mischief, constantly in trouble, and nowhere near as sensitive as his big brother. Although Harry was quite possibly mistaken as not a cause for alarm, but simply put, he just takes pleasure in misbehaving. Former protection officer for Diana, Princess of Wales, and their sons, Ken Wharf, remembers how captivated the little prince was by technology and how much he enjoyed playing with the police radio. The youngster would be given a task in one of his games which he created. One day, however, instead of staying hidden on the Kensington Palace grounds as planned, he radioed Ken from a record store on the high street, shocking him beyond belief. He was told to report back right away. Diana was always assured that her sons were usually fine, despite the dissolution of her marriage. "I'm talking about Harry in particular," she said. "It's as though nothing ever gets to him. However, I ensure they can always ask me anything, and that we have a constant dialogue about anything and everything, and because I never had such affection, I lavish it on my children." I guess it's encouraging to learn that Harry still considers himself a mischievous person inside, despite everything that's occurred to him in recent years. Unfortunately, the first 3 episodes show little of that happening. As it turns out, we're treated to a story of prejudice, hatred, and love. Harry and Meghan's love story is adorable and captivating. Of course, if only you're really interested and more invested in them, you only yearn for more detail on their dating and life as a royal couple. Even while there is no proof to corroborate the worst of Harry's assertions, the abuse he alleges was directed towards his wife and children is still highly upsetting. Despite this, Harry has been known to spew genuine hatred towards press members, including the accredited press, specialists, royal correspondents, and paparazzi. True, the prince claims he is responsible for exposing the exploitation and bribes within the media, but some would say it's an outrageous claim with no basis in fact. Of course, some people get paid to tell their experiences, but wait a minute, Harry, haven't you and Meghan just been paid millions to spill the beans about your own family and country? It does come across as the pot calling the kettle. Racism, even if it was unconscious bias, has been accused of being pervasive in British culture at large and within the royal family. Indeed, Harry has discovered his voice, and in doing so, he has demonstrated that he is more Spencer than Windsor. His mother is someone he looks up to, since he knows she made her decisions based on feelings rather than rational ones, and he certainly admires those who have achieved this. Harry proudly proclaims his identity. Losing his mother had left him so devastated that he had blocked out most of his childhood. And by saying he was left to deal with her death without much help, support, or guidance, he quickly takes a shot at his father. But just 5 years ago, he hailed the king for having been there for his sons following Diana's death and doing his utmost to safeguard them. On a brighter note, Harry recalls a carefree and adventurous upbringing where he got into trouble but didn't get caught. A piece of advice from his mother he clearly values. He learned his lesson the hard way. A low point would be getting caught on camera or playing strip pool in a Las Vegas hotel room or wearing nothing more but a necklace. The costume party where he went as a Nazi was also a bad move. He says that wearing the uniform was by far one of the worst decisions of his life, and that he felt compelled to seek retribution by meeting a Holocaust survivor in Berlin. Although Diana was not physically present to correct his errors, he does recall her as a guardian who kept him safe from the prying eyes of the media and paparazzi throughout his youth. His animosity toward the media had been building since childhood. He states that he felt uneasy from the get-go in front of the cameras. In fact, there's a scene in the documentary where Diana and her sons are skiing, and she is clearly in a warrior mindset. She stormed across the snow to clap her hand in front of a cameraman's lens and beg him to give her boys some privacy from the press. 80 cameras pointed at the royal family, and the princess was understandably upset that she felt she had to take drastic measures to safeguard her sons. As she put it, "I feel violated. I know I overuse the phrase raped, but I genuinely feel violated by those watching eyes. I told the cameraman to back off since he was making our lives miserable." Oddly, she didn't mention Harry, but she did say that William disliked the cameras and that he would have to grow used to them. According to her, he had a range of emotions, but it turns out that his sibling was also equally emotive. In the documentary, Harry uses Diana as an example of the pain and suffering women experience when marrying into the royal family. He fails to mention Diana voluntarily disbanded her security detail, or that she frequently coerced a small group of reporters and photographers, providing them with information and even letting them tag along on official royal engagements. However, he did discuss his mum's appearance on Panorama. He thinks she was telling the truth about her experience on the TV programme, even though a rogue journalist stole the footage.
Do you think Mrs. Parker Bowles was a factor in the breakdown of your marriage?
Well, there were three of us in this marriage, so it was a bit crowded.
Prince William has officially demanded that the interview not be aired again, so using the material from Panorama is likely to make him very unhappy. Harry has discovered a new role model in Meghan, from whom he has gleaned valuable insights. "My mum and Meghan have a lot in common regarding who they are and how they act. She's just as caring, empathetic, confident, and as warm as my mother." The most significant difference is that Diana had firm faith in the monarchy. Harry is correct in saying she went through pain and suffering, resulting from a hopelessly dysfunctional marriage. Diana would now be Charles's queen if the happy ending had held. By contrast, Meghan seems baffled by the entire monarchical system, with its formality, hierarchy, and established order. Evidently, it came as quite a shock to learn that she had joined not just a family, but also a business, and one in which she would never have the opportunity to hold the CEO position. She feels she was left to her own devices, but she did her best to blend in and not stand out. Moreover, she claims she didn't want to shame the family, yet she seems oblivious to the irony in her statement. And in any case, Meghan, you've gone and done it. The punches in this current assault have hurt, but they haven't done much damage so far. The royal family may be more embarrassed when the conclusion to the bloodletting finally appears. Despite the show's popularity, viewers are still sceptical that Netflix's portrayal of the Sussexes' version of events is realistic. And although the couple's best efforts to warrant favouritism, Harry and Meghan are widely regarded as two of the least appealing members of the royal family. They hope to prove in this series that widespread popular disapproval results from orchestrated media campaigns ordered by the palace. But only time will tell who ends up with the more widespread support, but the survey gives little hope to both Harry and Meghan.